everybody for coming. And I'll make a motion that we accept the minutes of April 12th.
Any discussion?
No.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Do you want to make a motion on the 15th minutes of the work session you did?
Oh, yes.
April 15th.
I'll make a motion that we accept the minutes of the April 15th minute.
Okay.
At the Harvey Place, the bottom of the road.
Second.
Okay, I wasn't there, so I'm not going to vote on this one. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Like, type good one?
Very nice. Thank you.
Yeah, better than mine, come handle it. And approve the weekly manifest for the amount of $20,153.83.
Second.
Any discussion?
No.
Lawrence, all set?
Okay.
Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Now we go to public comment, and I will ask if anybody has a time constraint, you know, they could go first, but other than that, going with a time constraint, okay, just general public comment, first hand up, Mr. Cobble, and just please state your name and say resident if you're a resident.
Mike Cobble from School Street, Bethlehem.
Yep.
Just following up, we were here last week.
Yep.
To talk about the dilapidated building next to it.
Yep.
Just following up to see if progress has been made.
Yeah, I did not see any communication from our attorney today, so you did.
Yes, I contacted him, and he's getting started on that process.
Good. And just update too, we noticed today when we went by, the front door is open, and we know the back door is, so it's in essence.
Just so you're aware of it, the chief's right behind you there.
Yep.
Did you inform the police department?
No, we just noticed it today.
Okay.
We will.
All right, thank you. Any other public comment? Just last name and...
Jennifer Murphy, Plantation Road.
Yep.
I think you're going to be going over this, but I was just wondering if there is a timeframe for putting the calcium chloride down the roads, the dirt roads?
Lawrence, you spoke with a guy, it's going to be moderately soon, but we were thinking about using half as much twice.
Right. Yes.
Right.
We don't have any time on it yet, no.
Okay, because last year it seemed like it was quite late in the season, and it's already, the dust is terrible right now.
So it's a question of the grading schedule, but once the road's been graded, do we usually try to get a second grading in before we do that, or?
Well, in the past we have, but this year is different, so.
Right.
In the past, it was, you know, we just skipped over them.
Right.
But this year, it's totally different.
Well, the guy, I mean, you did mention that the people from Allstate apply it, did make a recommendation that we use the same amount, but we just apply it twice.
Right.
Now, does that strike you as a good idea?
Well, what it does, it gives us a coating in early in the spring,
right,
and it will give us another one in the beginning of the summer.
Right, yeah.
So it makes it, I guess, it makes it last longer.
Right. Now, as far as we have X amount budgeted, and generally speaking, the materials eats that up, I got to consider that if they're coming twice the labor factor, and that's going to go up, so we're going to run into a problem on how much we have to spend.
Well, the labor will be just... What time he rides in the truck.
Right, but I'm just saying, usually we pay labor once. Right. If we do it twice, we pay labor twice.
Right.
And so if it's $400 for the day, that's $400 less material that we can actually purchase. So did we have any remainder last year? Or do we spend it a penny on that?
I'm not sure.
Okay.
I think the benefit outweighs what the cost is.
Okay, well, I mean, I think it's a good idea. And so if we're going to do it twice, we could pretty much jump on it as soon as all the dirt roads are ready.
Yeah, we can do it early. Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
So,
do we wait for all the roads to be ready? Or?
No, we could. All we need is just enough for one load.
All right.
And then, you know, they schedule the next load when they get that much done again.
Right.
So, I guess we could set it up for most any time now.
All right, so what you're saying is that if we were doing one application, the truck will have to come into town, leave, and refill and come back anyways, right? If we were doing a single application, they don't carry enough in the vehicle to do the entire town at once. So the truck is in the past has left, filled up, and come back.
Well, sometimes they used to bring a tanker.
Right.
And then the distributor would come back and Okay.
And
fill up.
Right.
A couple of times out of the tanker.
So are you comfortable trying to work out a schedule with him on that? Because Lenny's point being is that in one sense we don't have to wait till all the roads are graded. We just have to wait until enough to fill to empty the truck once.
One load. Yes.
Yeah. Are you happy working that out?
Yeah.
With him?
Okay. I can get involved in it.
Okay.
You want me to ask Bruce to call Bob at Alston and let him know that we're going to go with half of the gallons?
Yeah.
So, from the sound of it, I can't give you a date, but it looks like Florence probably within the next 3 weeks.
Oh, yeah, but even before that.
Okay.
That will be one. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Appreciate it. My animals have developed some breathing issues,
right.
So it's a little concerning to me.
Right. I do know I live on Old Pound, and when they first graded it, the dust was just unbelievable.
Yeah.
But, you know, fortunately, we got a little moisture in the air, and it's packed it down a bit, so it's not quite so bad. But you have no shade on that section of road, so it gets... Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All right. Any other?
I can on Hawks Road. I mean, I was curious. I know that HEB's been in a couple of times.
Yeah.
This fornier?
Yes.
And I know that they had offered to do the request for proposal on Stevens Road Bridge if we needed it done. And I thought you guys were going to tackle that yourselves in an effort to save some dollars. I was just curious, did we get a price from them, an estimate on what a request for RFP would cost?
Not particularly. I think the way it stands right now is that I've got a draft RFP taken off from a couple other towns that we're going to work on tonight. Then I have to attach all the particular aspects about what we require for insurance and bonding and that kind of stuff to it. I think the Stevens Road project is something that this particular group of selectmen can handle, and I think the RFP is moderately simple as RFP goes. What he was primarily in, once he realized that was happening, he was aware of that before he came in, was primarily talking about the Granite Road project. I will say that my opinion is on the Granite Road project is I really would like to have an outside source handle that kind of from start to finish because it's more complicated. It's a bigger water course, some other issues like that, and it doesn't look to me like something that we would start because funding is an issue here, and so it's going to be at least a two-year project with getting everything done and getting the funding and all that to do the bridge. Select bodies can change in that time period, so I'd be a little leery about taking the Granite Road side of it and trying to do it in-house, just because of the scope of the project and the length of time on it. I have some concerns about that, but the Stevens Road one, we're pretty well along. Lawrence has done a lot of work on what the materials cost and as far as, you know, buying the wing walls and all that kind of stuff in the culvert itself. Part of the RFP that we're looking at that is in the draft I have is part of the responsibility whoever puts in a bid is that they liaison with, in this case, I think it's Michi Corporation they gave us the best price on the culverts and stuff so that the calendar of events, we don't have work half finished and then something else not show up till next day. But that's, I think, the biggest hurdle right there is just getting everything all done within the shortest possible period of time. But I do feel in that particular project, this is that this board is competent to handle that particular job.
Okay.
But Granite Road's another issue, and we haven't made a decision on that. So.
Well, I know, Lawrence, I believe you stated that the plan has most of the things you'd want in the RFP anyway, outside of any penalty phases or timelines and workmanship and material kind of thing. So you can pretty much steal it all right from
them,
I guess. But I didn't know if you were going to get a price from them to see if it would save you guys a bunch of time, put a checklist together off what you want, off the plan, see what they put it together for, because they probably have it pretty standardized. They do a lot of and it's probably, there's four bridges out there that we really are looking at, right? Hutchins Pond, Snow Road, Granite, and Stevens. So I didn't know if it'd be, you know, advantageous for you guys to look at that, because that would probably be divided by four projects, you know, long term.
Right.
So the cost would be negligible.
Yeah. But
I did want to say one thing, because I've been trying to keep up with your work sessions, is when you were talking about the Michi Corp thing, and I think it's great what Lawrence has got together on it, they have a copy of that. The price is good. It's highway load, highway load 93, which makes no sense to me, but it's 103 and a half tons. It's what the state would use for a load rating for highways. But the price looks good. There's some incidentals in there. It'll probably bring it up to about $47,000, which is a good price. You were talking about unloading and scheduling things. Like, I think you roughly threw out that the guy with the backhoe would be there, but you can't unload 20 tons with a 7-ton backhoe.
Right.
So I didn't know if that was going to be a crane issue. And if it was, I was kind of just a food for thought. If you put your proposal out, and you can put it out so that you can have it two ways. One, you guys could schedule delivery dates and unloading and inspection. And you can also put out, you know, option B for the contractor to schedule a date, unloading and inspection of the material, because that's a critical point. I mean, you can't really put this stuff just anywhere, and what do you move it with? If it's moved with a crane, you've got to put it off the side and
right.
Put it there. So you might want to look at that, because the contractor probably would appreciate keeping control of the project. So you buy it, and then he or she schedules the delivery
Basically, that's the way the draft of the RFP reads right now. I mean, it needs to be tweaked and everything, but that's what we're putting in there. And just, you didn't bring it up, but the other thing that's part of this is that there is going to be an engineering oversight on it.
Yeah, no, I caught that part of it. But I was just thinking, you know, it's one of those things where you don't want to be liable for getting it too early and being in the way, getting it too late.
Yeah.
I mean, these guys not get a paycheck for a week.
As far as assurances, I can't offer anything. I don't know if, Lawrence, you can offer in this sense, but I have a feeling the way it works is that we buy the material from what we need from Michi. We pay for that, and it's on site, and whoever's doing the work ends up connecting with them and having it delivered on the right day.
Michi would deliver the product,
right.
But if...
They don't unload it, though.
No, the contractor would have it ready. When they take it off the truck, they set it right into the...
Right.
Inside at the same time.
That's why I thought having the contractor...
So the contractor would be the one that would be scheduled.
And that is one of the things that a note might think, because when I was putting together this draft, some information I didn't have on the tip of my tongue, and one of the aspects was is to make sure that we list in there what's going to be required that the contractor have to unload and install the culverts and the wing walls.
Well, I missed that in your work session, and that was the thing I was kind of concerned about, is getting a crane for a day can be problematic because they get caught up on bigger jobs or getting a bigger job offer.
Right.
They don't show up or... below a hydraulic line, and you know, doesn't have to have the fitting, you're down for 5 hours, 4 hours fixing it. 15 gallons of hydraulic in a wet area, in a wetland.
All I can tell you now is that at the time I was writing the draft, I was aware enough of that concern to mention the fact that we really need to nail down what the requirements are for the contractor in the sense of what equipment needs to be on site when they unload and install. It will be.
That just seemed like a weak area. If we got our fingers in the pie, sort of planning-wise, timeline, that could, you know, your performance issues all come into play because delays.
There is a section on performance issues and times. Now, they're blank lines right now in the sense of dates and stuff like that. I mean, we need to sit down as a board and say what's a reasonable length of time for this to happen and stuff like that. And it's be part of it. Be responsibility to make sure things are done in time. But hopefully we'll get to work on that some tonight and get it down to pretty close to a finished draft.
It was kind of my thought process, the idea of somebody keeping control of the project, delivery date, unloading, all of that, would be a bonus to whoever was bidding on the job, because no contractor wants to give up part of a kit, you know, the centerpiece of the operation to somebody else.
Lawrence, it was pretty much your intention that whoever gets to bid, part of the RFP will stipulate they're in charge of doing all that.
If you look at the plan, it's referenced in the...
Well, I only caught the video of your work session, and it didn't play out that way. That's why I came to ask those questions.
Yeah, no, I appreciate it.
No, great. It looks good. And I think it was great that Chris Siemens brought you the information on Michi Court, because it does look like a pretty good place. So kudos to Chris.
Thank you. Anything else in public comment?
Maureen Spencer, Old Town Road. I was just curious as to whether you guys had come to a decision on who was doing the sand in the library parking lot.
Currently, no. Lenny Dickinson. Lenny, you talked to somebody.
I talked to Paul Miller today. He's going to get a price from Paul. Because Coleman will sweep it and all, I guess, has to haul sand.
Already gave it to you today?
He did. $600.
Oh, there you go.
But you're going to hand sweep? That's what I was thinking.
No, machine.
Is that for all of them? For the three parking lots.
Oh, yeah. $600?
That was from Coleman?
Well.
Him and Coleman?
Yes.
Him and Coleman?
Yeah.
So the price for both of them, $600 for all of them?
Right.
Does that need a motion from us? No, to expend it? It seems reasonable, just go ahead and do it? $600?
No, we'll have to make a motion that we spend it, yes. If that's who we're going to, we're Coleman.
Well, I believe Paul knows somebody that's renting the Coleman, and they're going to keep it an extra day or two.
Right.
He's planning on this Thursday or Friday.
Okay.
It's station number 2, the library and this building.
And this building. Go ahead and do it?
Yeah.
Yeah, $600 is a good price.
Okay.
He did also say $200 for the cement, probably less.
Yeah.
And $800 would be his estimate on the cemeteries for Memorial Day.
Now, the $200 for the cement, is that just to repair what's there? Is he going to replace that first?
I don't know. I'll ask him.
Yeah, because we did look at that when we were viewing the houses.
Only a...
And our estimation is...
It was an inch thick, so that first section should be taken out and re-poured.
Right, yeah, all the way from the door down to the corner and then the ramp to the parking lot, the whole thing should probably be redone, because you're right, it's half inch of cement.
It's very thick.
We could just put linoleum.
We need tomorrow vacation.
Oh, for how long?
I think he said a week.
So Thursday and Friday?
Well, if he's got that kid renting it.
I see.
Somebody's coming. But I mean, if you want to ask him for prices and stuff, he'd be gone.
Yeah, exactly. I'll give him a call tonight before I go.
Okay, and I just need to make a couple announcements. There will, as the new policy is, there will be no...
I wasn't done.
Oh. Pardon? I thought I could get away with that.
Send it all.
No. I just wanted to let you guys, everybody know the CPR class for Friday is full. And I have been sworn in as the trustee for the Silent Corps, but your wife needs to get sworn in. And I don't know if anybody got in touch with Paul Potter about his involvement, because we need to have a meeting. So if you could tell your wife to come get sworn in, that would be good. And let me know when you do.
She can do it Thursday. And I'll try and get a hold of Paul.
Yeah, that'd be good, so we can get together. I'd appreciate that. Now I'm done.
Okay. As per the new schedule, there will be no selectmen's meeting next Tuesday. And as far as I know, we may make a decision tonight when we're looking at the RFP that we want to get together and work on that, but that'll be reflected in the minutes and stuff. But as it stands right now, we have no particular reason to have a work session on next Tuesday, although things may change. And just so everybody's aware of this, we've got April 30th will be roadside cleanup. Pretty much I think everybody was here that we said that last week. But you can meet here, I guess, about 8:30, so you can sign up. You got a road assignment, which I do recommend rather than just go out and clean up a road. It's nice for them to know which roads got cleaned up, because they usually have somebody goes around and picks up bags that people couldn't move themselves. And there is the barbecue afterwards. Or cookout, I guess. All right. We did have a couple of issues, or not concerns, but a couple of things that came up in the action folder. Ralph Thompson is willing to go to a...
No. You can't read that.
What?
No. Read it. Said I would be willing to pay to have someone with authority.
Oh, yes, that's the way that
goes. I don't have authority for that.
Okay, all right. Well, it strikes me as that between us, somebody should go to this. It's a decent thing to pick up on. I don't mind doing it.
I don't mind going to it either. In fact, I'd like to go.
You'd like to go?
Yep.
I got to admit, the way I look at this is if I can get one of our selectmen to go and give a decent report on it, I see no reason for two. I don't have a problem paying for two people to go, but if that's something you like to learn more about.
Lawrence knows more about roads than he's forgotten more knowledge than
that. All right, so.
Well, it's just on, it's on erosion control and that.
Right.
You know, like you were talking about on the one road.
Yeah,
and best practices and all that kind of stuff. So you willing to do this?
Oh, yeah.
You want me to enroll you? Mm-hmm. Want me to enroll you?
Yep.
And this is the May 6th.
What date is that? I thought I wrote it down before.
This one is May 6th. Yep.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So probably that's back in here, okay?
Okay.
For the moment.
So you don't think you need two of us to go, right? Or three of us or whatever?
No.
More than that.
If you want to go, go, Lenny.
Oh,
I've got a couple other meetings that I'm going to be running up to Concord and stuff like that. So,
for later.
Okay, thank you. If you want to go, just let Claudia know, and she'll sign up two of us, the two of you.
Yeah.
I think that's good.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, you said one could go.
Yeah.
Cover it.
Well,
you just kind of get out of it.
Thanks, Glenn. Jeez, I thought that was being subtle. So, all right.
So,
well, look at it this way now. You may be a lot longer than I am.
And then there's just so you're too aware of it, what's the date on this one? 29th or something. April 29th, I got to head to Manchester to meet with our attorney in relation to Kent Marist issues, so. I'll do that. So let him know that if you pass on my phone number to him, and I can meet him someplace.
Yes, his office is right across. You're meeting him at the office.
Okay, yep. All right. I have no idea where that is, but
yeah.
Okay. And it looks like I'm meeting him at something like 6:30 in the morning too. It's at 9 o'clock in Manchester.
Well,
9 o'clock
is when you need to be there.
Yeah. Okay. And so, but his office is in Manchester?
Yes.
Oh, okay. So,
right on,
but I have to get up at 6 to get to Manchester. So.
No.
Goodness.
I'll do anything, you know?
We'll remind you of that.
Yeah. Yeah. You know so much sitting. You know so much. Yeah, I wouldn't crawl underneath the building or back, but, you know, pretty much anything else. And then, what did I have here? That's done. That one's done.
Speaking of phone numbers, did you get a cell phone yet?
No.
I
don't have one. But I work at home a lot, so I'm usually there. But, just as under comments, what's our comments and report? Who's our fourth?
Rebecca's up, but.
Right, okay.
Like
I
said,
she never knew. Right. I did attend a little lecture in Concord on FEMA applications, and I got signed on to the FEMA webpage. And one of the things is these grants are for preventative maintenance. I mean, in the sense that if you have a culvert that floods all the time, there's a possibility of getting FEMA money to fix that culvert. So I'm thinking of the culvert that's too small on Molly Philbrook Road. And what I was hoping is that the information that you got out of on sediment control and stuff from culverts on Bonnieman Road, that information might be able to be attached to this particular application. The application process is pretty soon. I mean, it's only like May 7th or something. So, but I'm going to practice on this, and I may be able to, and I mean may, be able to get grant money to fix that particular culvert. Now, it's may on two issues, is whether or not I can learn to do this in time and gather the information, the photographs and everything else. And the other one is that the money will come through.
So is this a hazard mitigation grant?
Yes. Yeah.
Randy's familiar with doing those.
Right, yeah. So I was thinking,
as emergency management.
Right, and I was thinking of talking with him about that, but I just feel
he's already applied for something and gotten funding.
Right, but when I did ask, because, you know, there were few people there, so we had a chance to really chat, and I was talking about this one particular issue. And they said, well, they do a lot of culvert stuff for hazardous mitigation. So I'll continue to work on that. But as I said, I'm not promising we can get a grant, but there's a possibility that we could on that. So what I'll end up needing is what size culvert we need, and then just basically listen to what you learned about erosion off of Bonnieman Road. So this is sort of under comments and reports, and so if the two of you want to discuss what you found out about.
Is there any strings attached to this grant?
Oh, there's, you've got to have like 20%, and there's, they don't pay 100% of it, but they pay a significant portion of it. But as far as follow-up and stuff like that, there's a degree that they need, you need proof that you did what you said you were going to do. But I don't think it lasts a long time.
Like other grants, we submit a detailed invoice that we've already paid and they reimburse.
Yeah. So there's a possibility, but as I said, I'm using this as a project to drive home the lessons I learned at that particular class. You know, they spoke a lot about, you know, as much written document, photographic documentation that you can have and everything else, talking with experts in it, the information that you got about erosion control to protect a water source like the lake can be applied to this because it goes into the same lake. I'm not positive exactly that there's a lot of erosion that's coming from that small, the culvert is too small, but that's the kind of information I can spend some time with you and we can talk that out. But we do know that it needs to be replaced. Now, whether or not I can get it under hazardous mitigation is questionable, but possible. So
the Townhouse Road culvert was done with hazard mitigation.
Right, yeah. Yeah, from when I talked with the guy that I talked with there, he said that's sort of the nuts and, you know, that's the base. They give out a lot of grants for culverts because it spreads the money around the state really well because they're, generally speaking, not hugely expensive programs. I mean, fixes, and they have a lot of benefit, so. And they do allow us how they like communities to receive the grant because people feel better about FEMA grants if they're getting them themselves. So just under comments and reports, how did it go up at Molly Filbert? I mean, Bonnieman Road.
Oh, it was 7 or 8 people I had. There was 2 from the Acton Watershed Association.
Yeah.
There's 2 from a university,
yeah.
Which were, them 2 guys was pretty good. And then there was a couple from the Parvis Lake Association.
Right.
And there was one lady from the DES.
Yeah.
And they first talked about cutting Grapevine's driveway. It's a paved driveway. They talked about cutting that back and putting the culvert in. And they kind of got away from that because they didn't want to get into private stuff. They wanted to do stuff that was on the town, so
right.
Go to start from Grapevine's driveway and go down as far as the culvert that runs into that pond.
Yes, by the little cemetery there?
Yeah,
yeah, okay.
Because there's a lot of sediment going into the pond,
right.
And you want to prevent that sediment from going in there. So they was talking about making a ditch from Grapevine's driveway to there and lining it with fabric and putting erosion stone on it.
Yeah.
And they will pay for the materials, but they won't. You have to furnish the labor and the machines.
So you do the excavation, and they provide whatever materials make it more effective.
And they're going to come up with a plan, and then they'll bring it in and talk to us about it.
Okay. So do you think the kind of information that you heard about there might apply to if we replace the culvert up on Molly Field?
Yeah, it'd be the same thing. Yeah.
Same thing. Yeah. Okay.
They didn't get their grants from FEMA, though, did they?
No. This is...
Because they got grants to buy the materials.
It's a state grants called the DES lady.
Yeah.
Right.
And she said she would keep... They would keep funding these projects until they see the effects and the quality of the water in the lake.
Right. And Lenny, it's the information that I'm interested in a sense to apply, to attach to a FEMA grant is the effect that this will have on improving the water systems and stuff like that. So if you're trying to get the grant money to replace it, if there's a way to, at the downstream side of it, if there are things we can do to make it the lake safer, you know, water quality and all that, and I can get that written into the grant and we have to pay less for it. Overall, Providence Lake's pretty important to us in the sense of tax base and it's a sensitive body of water. So anything we can do around the lake to reduce the amount of phosphates and stuff that are getting into the lake is great. But it does add a little more to the importance of getting this particular culvert fixed. And so, you know, the information I came from is if it's a benefit, mention it. You know, and B, be inventive about what benefits are. They like to see a lot of documentation. So if there's something from the organization that did the design studies on the fixes that you're talking about, if they would be willing to give me the information, I'll attach that to a grant application.
Yeah, they said it'd take about a month for them.
Yeah.
And then the watershed people and I guess the UNH group will come right to Sutton's meeting and present it to us.
Right, okay. Yeah. All right.
And also what they do will also say, because everything that washes into that retention pond, you get it replaced.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Oh, in the sense you paid to put it down, you paid to
Yeah, you haul the gravel in the road, right. Now it ends up in the pond, right. Now you're hauling it in there again.
Right, yeah.
So,
yeah.
I mean, it'd be money saved in the long run.
Yeah. So how many culverts were they looking at on Bonnyman overall?
They wasn't looking at any culverts.
I mean,
they were just looking at putting a ditch down that the left-hand side of that.
Okay, well. All right.
It wasn't looking at any culvert.
All right, and then
down as far as the culvert that's there is adequate to take care of what
right.
water would come.
What's out. There, and then you design the ditch so that less particulate matter filters down.
Well, they put the erosion stone in there to stop all of the sediment from coming down right. through.
You know. Now, are you talking just a big crushed stone?
Yeah, broken.
Okay.
Regular river.
All right, but they still haven't figured out how to keep those from filling in with sand, have they?
Oh, no. Yeah. No, they're still going to fill out. In fact, in the front of the, before they get to the culvert, they're talking about putting a wall in.
Yeah.
And so that the sediment stopped.
And then you dig that out.
Right? And then the lady from the Active Regis, she says they have about 11 kids.
Yeah.
That's what they do. They go around and clean out these things.
Right.
So, next thing is get them to do it, but she did say they had, I think it was 11 kids, right?
Yeah, it's a Wakefield Conservation Corps or something.
Right. Something like that, yeah, I forgot what she called it. Yeah. But anyway, they go around and they clean these out by hand.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
So it's
which keeps it from the water body, right?
Well, yeah. They put like a bar there.
Yeah, I understand.
And the bar stops the sediment.
Right.
The water runs over the top.
Right.
But if once that fills up, of course, sediment's going to run.
Right,
so it's got to be cleaned out once a year.
Right. Yeah. Cool. Good. Well, thank you for doing that. Okay. So we got roadside cleanup. Just a civil change. Jonathan's not here. Oh, I do have one. So under old business, I do have a draft that I have it on the computer. We can look at that tonight, and there's a couple of things, and I'll just go over it and move it along another step because we really have to kind of set ourselves a date that sort of by the end of this month we want the RFP completed. So
we got to get moving because they take, I think he said it takes 4 weeks to get a plan up.
Right.
And then it takes, I think he said 6 weeks to make the, to make the
concrete.
Right.
All right, but isn't the plan, the engineering plan we have done, doesn't that already indicate what the cement needs to be, what the culvert size needs to be, and what the wing wall size needs to be?
Yes, we have all that, but until we give him the go-ahead, he's not going to make anything, so... The first thing is to make a set of shop drawings, and he said that's 4 weeks.
Right okay. Now. Well, I mean, I see no reason not to go ahead doing that now. I mean, we've kind of made a commitment within ourselves for the town to pre-purchase
the material. Well, the only trouble with doing it now is if something.
DES
doesn't approve it,
and
yes,
we got to change something.
So until we hear from DES, but when our plan is approved by DES the next day, technically, we could call Michi and say, okay,
yes.
Start pouring, or start your plan. All right, okay.
Yeah.
Good.
But they said, what, 5 days that DES?
Right, yeah.
And he told me today they lost 2 people, so it's going to be slower than...
So it's one of them on Bonnyman? Wandering around out there?
Yeah. No, he said, that DES lost 2 people, so they're going to be slower than...
And I'm assuming that it does no good to call DES up and say, we're in a hurry here. Yeah, I don't think that helps.
Okay.
It helps with septic systems that have broken down.
Okay, right.
That's it.
Right. Okay. So we really are, until DES comes along, we can continue to craft our RFP, but until DES approves the plan, we're stopped.
Yeah, but okay. The thing is, we want to, we got to get this going, because we got to get this in by the end of August, 1st of September.
Okay.
That's when the water...
Lowest water.
So the minute we get an approval, then right. We need to start doing it.
Yeah, well, and that's why I look at it's important to get the RFP. If we can get it done by the end of the week...
I've done some more work on the RFP.
Yeah, good. So we just put that stuff together tonight and move it along. Okay. I think Claudia, as I said, the one part that is really, I'm sure that we have in the sense of our legal and technical and bonding and stuff requirements, we have copies of that and other things that we can copy paste.
Well, I'm going to ask the insurer what we would be looking at for liability insurance.
Okay.
I mean, we have a standard
okay.
requirement, but a bridge project, so...
Yeah, all right.
$1 million a drop in the bucket if something went wrong.
Well, I was hoping to be able to come down tomorrow and spend some time with Cheryl on the design and kind of the new agenda and stuff. What?
It's not tomorrow.
She's leaving at noon time.
Oh, all right. Yeah, I got you. Well, plus, I have something else on my schedule.
I'll be here. Yeah.
You've been picking on me over there.
That's great.
That's what I discovered that. So... Anyways, you can see why doing the calendar is so important to me. But I want to apologize for people. The agenda really has not been followed up, but we are redesigning it a little bit, trying to get some other stuff in there. So set up a calendar. There we go. All right. So under old business, do you have anything particular you want to bring up?
Well,
on old business?
Did we ever get the signs for the salt shed?
Sure. Yeah.
Salt shed or the transfer station?
No, salt shed. We were supposed to get some no trespassing signs and put up there. Did we ever get those?
Oh, we got salt here. Not no trespassing. I don't recall no trespassing. Did I miss that? Did it go right through?
I think it went right by the shed.
Perhaps so.
Well, we ought to put them up because...
They may have been ordered and put in there.
Right. It'll be...
So we got the salt here.
Yes.
Those. Yes. Okay. So... Did you happen to check what signs were in your witness check?
Oh, I did. I didn't see nothing
you
in
there. You didn't see any? Oh. Yeah. We will get some. And how many, Lawrence, and how big?
I guess two. Well, they're only going to be just no trespassing, so it gives us some...
Right. Now, one of them you want to kind of like just put right on the sign pile, right? I mean, because that was one of the issues is people coming in and riding bikes and stuff on the sand pile.
Yeah, one on the building, somewhere there.
Yeah, okay. So two.
Passing in. Yeah. Right.
So
covers us. Someone.
12 by 18, is that big enough, or did you want it larger than that?
No, 12 by 18 is plenty.
Yeah.
You ought to be able to see that.
And any news on having the guy come out and look at the transfer station, when that can happen?
Yeah, he came out like...
Right, I just didn't know if we had any scheduling on it. Stuff
oh,
like that.
No.
Not yet.
The Granite Road Bridge, I did talk to Steve Gard and...
From where?
From the Mitchell Corporation.
Yeah.
Because he had some two engineers that he had dealt with in the past.
Mm-hmm.
He was going to have check, see which one would, come out. But... They are kind of skeptical about putting their name on them abutment because nobody knows what's behind them. Nobody knows what have they got reinforced in there. They don't know anything about them.
Right.
So his suggestion was to pour a new one behind the old ones.
Right.
And span right over the top of it.
And so the new one's going to take the weight of the bridge. The old ones are decorative at that point.
Yeah, other than... if you go and remove them, then you've got to get into the DES.
Well, no, I see no reason to take them out. I mean...
But he thought of just pouring a new abutment with wing walls
right.
behind the existing abutment.
Right.
That way there, he said he don't think they need to sign off on.
Well, no, I can understand that, because they basically have to dig out.
They don't even know. I called the state to find out if they had any information on it. They don't have
anything. Yeah.
So you don't know if they were done in 1920 or when they redone it in 1950.
Right.
So you don't even know what the how old they are.
Right.
But
well, in the sense of, this is just speculation at this point, Lawrence, but in the sense of incremental cost, it'd be nice to know what it would cost to have that done and the wing walls poured, whether or not we have span the bridge that particular year or not.
It's, well, he don't have a concrete figure.
Right.
But he said, just guessing off the top of his head, he said between 160 and 170.
Right. And essentially what you've got for that is you've prepared both sides of the river to accept a span.
Yeah, plus the, you know, the concrete box beams.
So you're actually, that's including spanning?
Yeah. Yeah, so you said 44 foot.
Really? That's interesting. All right.
So I mean, those wing walls going to be behind the existing walls of the day now?
Yes, because what's there is all
stone.
Stone. Yeah. It's not cemented in or anything. Right. It's loose. Some of it's fallen out. So just pour a concrete wing wall.
Yeah.
On both sides of it.
All right. Well, we can discuss that later. I mean, I want to get the Stevens Road done. And I do have concerns about Grant Road. We'll bring them up later. But so was there a date set on the transfer station to start the work there?
Nope.
All right. Are we ready to set a date?
I think so. I think the...
Are the batching plants open?
Yeah. Say that again?
Hot top plants open around here? I haven't seen anybody.
That's a good point, yeah.
I don't know what a Kilcon's open or not.
Right.
But we got to do work there first, so...
Yeah. So the way the earthwork, I mean, whether or not it was paved the same week that we did the earthwork, it's not...
Oh, it wouldn't matter.
Yeah, no. It wouldn't matter. No. A little dusty.
Actually, it'd be better to leave it anyway.
Let it settle a bit.
Yeah, let it compact it down.
So in that sense, I mean, you don't want to leave it too long. So if we knew that the concrete could be done in, say, 4 weeks, we could in 2 weeks, we could start doing the excavation and the leveling that we want to do.
Okay, let me check with Ben and see when he can do it, I guess.
Yeah, and then...
But he just said, whenever we get ready, he'll come and do it.
Okay.
That's how he put it.
Right, yeah.
We didn't set no date.
Well, the work he's done for us in the past has been pretty square, so I'm happy. All right. Anything else under old barns?
Well, we should get a load of co-patch.
Okay. Yeah. So, yeah. I've noticed a few potholes.
Do you want me to help out get that?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you have my email?
No, I don't. Okay. I have Lenny's, but I don't have yours. So write it down up there. So did you, Lawrence, did you get anything else for old? Lenny, do you have anything you want to put in under old business?
No, we talked about the cemetery, so, I mean, that'd be new, but, no, I got nothing under old business.
Okay, all right, well, under new business, one thing I wanted to bring up is that there was a suggestion made this spring that the placement of our road close signs are 50 yards down the road, and by the time somebody gets there in a bigger vehicle and thought of backing up. I was wondering about just going out and figuring out where to put a couple of signposts closer to the ends of the roads where we put the signs, so it's there in the winter. You know, we could put them in now, so to speak, but it's a place to put those signs later on that are closer to the ends of the roads.
Just put the posts in?
Just put the posts in, and then what it's for is to put those signs on. And that way next spring, they'll be at the end of the road that we're blocking off as opposed to, you know, 50 feet down the road.
Well, I think the only one we got to have is one for right field, one for maybe the end of Pine River.
Right, yeah.
So just two poles.
Yeah, I mean, it just made sense to me, right, to do that, because I thought it was a good idea, because I can understand the frustration of a truck driver. He pulls in the road, see, and then, you know, a minute later sees the sign. And the,
well, that's the thing. You get in there that far, and you can't turn it around.
And you can't turn it around. So, yeah, all right. Randy generally puts up signposts. The only thing is just to consider where to put it. I mean,
that one, yeah.
Yeah. So, in the sense that you're somewhat aware of where the huge snow piles from snow plowing stuff end up, things like that. What I don't want to do is put it to some place that in springs got 8 feet of snow, right? Would you mind just sort of looking to see if the spots?
Sure, I'll mark them.
Okay, great. And then once that's done, we'll let Randy know. You can put it in the post.
And
one second.
The thought that right field, you come out, you're an ostrich. They might not appreciate you putting the signpost up. Like, it might just be easier to coordinate with Ossipee about, is it okay for us to post a sign one of your posts when necessary?
We have an agreement with Ossipee.
Yeah.
We maintain to the end of that road, and they take the one next to Boyle.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Same would happen with
Pine Road. So that one may be as simple as just letting the person posting know, you can post it out on the Ossipee section closer to the end of the road.
Yep. All right. Lenny, new business?
Just cemeteries in the parking lots. And Claudia said she'd get the estimates on that.
Yeah. Well, in the cemeteries, what, getting it mowed by?
No, they just basically clean up branches and blowing the leaves out.
Okay.
There was no major trees down except for that one on Green Mountain Road, but. We'll have to talk about that. I don't know. That's the one he took care of, but that's major money right there.
Yeah, it does cost money to do everything.
Well, I mean, you'd have to get a machine in there to get rid of that tree and get landowner permission to get in there. So, and like I said, I don't know if it's on his land. I don't know if cemeteries work. If maybe the trees... Whoever's land it is, it's the tree's not in the cemetery. Well, it is now, but it didn't grow in the cemetery.
Right.
So maybe their insurance might pay if we could get a hold of the landowner.
Yeah, I believe that landowner contacted us when it came down, and he was perplexed about who was going to do what.
Yeah. I mean, luckily it didn't damage the stones or anything.
Yeah.
It sure is a big tree.
So if he's approached us... might Lenny get in touch with him just to see whether or not his homeowner's insurance covers collateral damage?
I'm sure he would have pursued that avenue. I'm going to think it doesn't, because it wasn't his tree.
Right.
It's just laying in part of his yard, correct?
No, it's right in the cemetery. In part of his yard,
yeah.
The top and everything.
Yeah, he primarily wanted to notify us that it was down there. That it, yeah, he said the same thing about it. It didn't hit any of the...
Yeah.
Were we interested in doing something about it? It was kind of a notification thing.
Yeah.
He said it was way too big for him to handle. If it were a smaller tree, he would be glad to help out with it, but
being as it's not on a roadside, it's not necessarily something that would go to our road guy. I mean, we still need somebody with, you know, doing work for the town, you still need somebody bonded with insurance to do stuff like that. So,
yeah, and it's, you know, it's private cemetery, but
right.
There must be a trust fund, because those are the ones that Peter Case told him to take care of, because they had funds.
All right.
You've never withdrawn money out of any funds.
No.
So he's getting paid somehow.
You know, it's, you know the deal. You have to, how much is the project, how many people do you have that are covered by trust funds? Can only, if it's 3 out of 10, you can only take 3/10 of what it cost.
Yeah.
So it's a pretty extensive burden of proof to get any of that money. And when you look at it, most of them, you deplete the fund.
Yeah, but the other issue,
because you can't spend the principal, you can only spend the interest.
Right.
The other issue is, I mean, I don't have a problem using whatever is available from the trust funds, but if it's not a municipally owned cemetery, the town shouldn't be spending money to remove the tree.
And that was my sad tale to the gentleman that reported it.
Yeah.
But I mean, if you can look at it too, if there's a trust fund to designated to take care of that lot, and he can't get at the lot because the tree's on it,
right?
Then what do you do?
Yeah, no, it's as anything that deals with maintenance of cemeteries that are not municipal property, it's questionable what you can and can't do.
Have you looked on in the town report to find out how much is in that? Is it called Barker Cemetery?
That one up there? Mm. I don't know what it's called. Mm. It's Bryant's, the name's on the stone.
That might be a place to start.
Right.
It has plenty of money in it, and there's enough graves that are covered.
Right. So, Lenny, what you need to do is figure out which
They're
one it is.
They're going to be needing some.
How many lots there are in the cemetery and how many lots have a trust fund associated with them.
Yeah, I don't even know what they'd call that.
Well, if you don't, Lenny, if you might poke around on that a little bit, and we'll bring this up again, but I mean, I have a real concern about spending taxpayer money on a non-municipal cemetery.
Well, that's something we'd have to bring up at town meeting and see if the people wanted to do something like that before we went and spent money on it.
Yeah, I mean, but the other side was, I understand that it'd be nice if the town could just go in there and cut the tree up and take it, because there really isn't anybody that's going around taking care of these cemeteries, so. But
all right.
Well, we'll let Lenny look.
Volunteers. Maybe if you put in.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, your column, perhaps. Yeah. A lot of people are very attached to cemeteries. Right.
Yeah. All right. Mm-hmm. So Lenny, just in the sense of talking with Peter on the information on what we could legally pull out of the trust, we could find out how much money's there, and then. If there's anybody else that's concerned about that cemetery. I mean, in one sense, I'm even a little leery about having the selectmen do this, because it's not a municipal property, but who else is going to do it? So, you know, I'd go ahead and see how much we could pull out of grants legally, out of trust legally on that, and then once we know how much money we have to operate with, we can make a decision on whether or not any other monies will be used. Okay?
Yeah, I mean, I'm sure he could work away, you know, get it out of there.
Right.
Equipment to, you know, he could chip all the brush, he said.
Right.
Limbs.
And the other issue, I don't know if the guy.
But then, you know, then he sends a bill to the town for $2,000.
Right.
You know?
Well, I told him,
I says, go do the other ones, but leave this one till I talk to somebody.
If you can drive up to it, maybe a log truck would be the best way to get there.
Just pick it up and lift it. Pick it out. Yeah.
Pick it out.
Right.
You know, it would be cheaper than it would be to haul a piece of equipment up there.
Yeah, you'd want to get permission from that guy to get a truck in there.
But if it's got a driveway to it, then I'm sure he'd be in agreement if we're going to clean it up.
All right, so you kind of want to just sort of delineate the problem
for
next week and then see?
If I can get a hold of the landowner.
Right, you know, I understand. Yeah, cool. Anything else you want to do on the new? You said no?
No.
Okay. Lawrence, anything you want to put on the table?
No, I got everything else right here.
All right. Can you think of anything we've forgotten?
Nope.
All right, are you too happy to stay, do some work session on the RFP? I mean, Lawrence's point being, this is that until we hear from DES, it's not a huge rush. I wouldn't mind putting some time into it as opposed to coming in for a couple hours next Tuesday, but I do know that this, we started with the meeting at basically 2 o'clock today, so you guys may want to get home for dinner, so it's a question of whether or not you want to do that tonight. You know, Lawrence's point being, if you have copies of what you have, I can take that home and sort of start feeding it into the draft, and now that I have the email, I can get you copies of the draft.
You want many.
But the thing is we won't get back to it for 2 weeks if we don't do something on it tonight.
Yeah.
You have the other one that I give you.
Right. Okay. If we don't do it tonight and it's 2 weeks away, I'm trying to think, does this really mess us up down the road? And if suppose DES called tomorrow and said, hey, you know, we got the plan approved tomorrow, right? The thing that we're really waiting for that plan for is that the day after that, you know, we set the plans in, great, let's get in touch with Michi and start the process on that. So we're still 4 weeks out on that.
Well, the thing is, we need to get the shotguns going.
Right.
Then we still going to have plenty of time to put the RFP out.
Okay, all right.
Because the shotguns is a month,
yeah,
and then it's 6 weeks to make the pre-cut. Yeah,
okay.
So we've got plenty of time.
All right, good enough. Okay. Then I see, other than that, do you have any reason that you'd want to do a work session tonight then?
Not unless you guys want.
But I think we should still continue to work on it.
Oh, definitely. Well, I can take this and read this, and I'll send you what I have, and we can start putting them together. And you know, as I said, I'm a little short on the very, you know, the linear dimensions and stuff like that. It's just, you know, I put a little note in there. I need to get this dimension, but I just tried down to put a list of everything we want.
Well,
in there.
I left that blank for the dates.
Right. Yeah.
Because we don't know what the date's going to be.
What happened with our road contractor today? We had stated that he was going to come here, speak with the board. Mm. And I know you reached out to him, and I spoke with Bob, too. Did you ever hear from him about not coming tonight?
No. I do have a question, though. You hadn't heard anything from him?
No, I didn't either. He said, we'll be there. I gave him his post note.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I was looking at, he was using that blower.
Mm-hmm.
And he was trying to, he went down Old Pound Road, and he actually went down Old Pound Road twice. And, I have a question about how effective that is. And we spent, basically last week, we spent close to $500 on that piece of equipment, using that piece of equipment last weekend.
Okay. If he brought the material into the road and had a loader to pick it up and a truck to pick it in and haul it off, it would have been 10 times what that blower cost.
Right.
So, yes, there's some areas where the blower is not going to work.
Right.
But the blower is a lot less expensive than it is to pick it up.
And the primary purpose of it is to get rid of as much organic material as possible, right?
Well, to get the leaves out of it.
Right.
The leaves is what, if you bring the leaves into the road, then what do you do with them?
Okay,
you gotta, it takes you three
right.
times as long to grade them.
Right.
Or you pick them up one of the
And then they hold moisture and...
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, it's an evaluation. When I went out and looked at it, I mean, one thing I saw when he was driving by is that the angle of the blower is designed to blow stuff off flat surfaces.
Yes. Now,
he could put a piece of sheet metal that gave him 4 degrees down from what he's already got, then I think he'd be a lot more effective.
He did. He done that.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think he might...
On your road, up above where the flat is,
yeah.
and the leaves are wet,
yeah.
in the ditch is damp,
yeah.
so it wasn't blowing them out of the
right.
out of the ditch.
Yeah.
So they put a deflector in there, so it would blow down.
Right,
and it would,
lifted it right out. Yeah. All right. So your feeling is that it's worth the cost for?
Oh yeah, I think it's way over picking them out.
Right. So what would have had to happen otherwise is they would have had to come in and excavate out the leaves and the sticks before they could do the grading. And
right.
now he's got, 70% of that done in a third of the time or something like that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's a lot less expensive, a lot quicker.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't disagree with the principle, but just when I looked at what was still remaining in the ditches, it looked to me like it's not doing quite what you'd want it to do.
Well, I think, he did. He took it back and put a deflector in there so that it would blow down.
Okay, some more. Yeah.
I mean, they don't have to play with anything.
Tweak it around a little
yeah.
bit. Right, okay. Yeah. yeah, it'd be nice to have something you could
Yeah, well,
alter.
They do have a pulley on there, and it had a gate.
Yeah.
So you could operate it from inside the tractor.
Right.
So they, when they come to something where they don't want to blow it, they just drop the gate.
Yeah.
You know, and then go inside. So they could do the same thing with a piece of flex pipe.
Yeah.
So that you could lift it and lower it, you know,
mm-hmm.
for whatever the situation was.
Right. Yeah.
So.
But he's willing to put the time into.
Oh yeah.
To design this for a particular function.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And then as far as the road budget goes, again, you know, we have X amount of money, $42,000 off the top, and that left us 30.
Well, some of this was graded, so.
Right,
yes.
Yeah, but I understand that. Yeah,
yeah
right.
I'll get that to you.
Yeah. Oh, and Cheryl, one other thing that has occurred to me is this. Are you the one that puts together when we get the intent to cut?
Yeah.
I've just started receiving them in, yes.
Okay, I was just wondering, would you mind putting a sticky note with the physical location of the property on those when they come through? It's a little handier for us to look at it, and then one of us might know that there's a road or wetland issue or something like that in that area.
Yep.
Well, I think the road.
I think it should have been marked there. Right on there.
Probably in the tent.
Yeah, but sometimes it's just nice to know location and stuff like that.
Something
that
comes up. Okay. Clarify.
Yeah. That is. I'm kind of surprised that we're at the end of the meeting here. So, anything else you wanted to bring up? And we're going to go to public comment. Yes. I did have one thing. Wait a second here. The selectman, we need to appoint, is it Dennis or Denise?
Dennis,
okay. Dennis Vivino as a library trustee for the term ending March 2017. And the reason for this is?
It's a ballot thing. It was what happened to one other member who got voted in.
Oh, this is a write-in vote.
Yeah, he was a write-in.
It had to do with the issue of write-in votes. The way the town had always done it was that if the person at the top didn't take it, they went down the list until someone did. Yeah, apparently that's not legal under state law. If the top person says no, it creates a vacancy in that position, and then it has to go through the usual process for appointment.
Right, and then next election cycle, that's
right, and you get elected for the remainder of the term.
Who's he being appointed for?
Library trustee.
For 1 year.
So I make a motion that the selectman appoint Dennis Vivino as library trustee for a term ending March 2017.
I'll
second that. Any comment? All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Speaking of the library, you flagpole, the rope works. And
I'll put the flag back on.
Yeah.
Didn't know it was an issue?
Yeah, it's broken.
Well, fix it.
I tied it together just to keep it from flapping around in the breeze. But unless someone has restrung it.
Oh, no, they just told me the rope was broke.
Right, but I just to keep it from, because I mean the whole rope was flapping in the breeze.
So it needs a new rope.
It needs a new rope. Oh. Yeah.
Well, then it isn't fixed. I haven't put the new rope on.
Okay.
I just got the rope and I'll have to look at it.
Yeah, I mean, I noticed it after that particularly wild rainstorm that I drove up and you could see that it was flapping. So I undid it just to get the flag to come down so the flag wouldn't flap around. And to keep the rope from flapping around, I just sort of tied the two ends together and looped it around the cleat again. But the rope is actually...
I was under the impression the rope was broken.
It is.
So it couldn't even be used. That was my impression.
Well, right, but I mean, I didn't tie it very well. I mean, the rope snapped apart. So it's not that it came untied. The rope actually did break
part
a little bit below one of the clips. Okay. So.
All right, I will go finish public comment, and then Rebecca's in and able to speak with us, and so we can do that after public comment. So. Last name and whether you're a resident.
Hey, Charles, Jack Russell. I just point a clarification on Granite Road Bridge.
Yeah.
I know we're going back and forth, and I know it's a one-lane bridge right now. Everything I saw was going to two-lane. Is that still holding true? I mean, I'm hearing all kinds of different things, so I'm just like
clarification. It has been put on the table during our discussions is when we do a design is to consider it as a one-lane bridge. If there's a significant, I mean, even if there's a cost savings, as long as our fire trucks can get over it, that's what I care about. So as far as the width goes, it's a cost structure. I mean, I got to assume that having a precast bridge that's narrower costs less than one that's the same length but wider, but maybe not much.
So we're talking a one-lane bridge?
If we repair what we have, it'll be the same width as what we have now. If we go with a total replacement, then it will be a two-lane bridge.
Does the town own all that property? Both sides? Because right now, I went down and looked, there's one lane in and out of the bridge. And if we went the size of Elm Street Bridge, I was measuring it up and I'm going, I just wondered if you knew that. That's all.
Well,
if the town actually owns that much land on both sides to put a two-lane bridge.
Yeah. Well, I don't think in any discussion, and this is all very preliminary, but I don't think in any discussion we've talked about making it wider than it originally was.
Well, the thing would be if
bridge plan shows it as a, talks about a double lane bridge for the state.
It would have to be surveyed, everything would have to be surveyed and find out where the town is right away.
Well, I mean, that's a concern.
To answer your question, we own it or not, I don't know.
Because that could really throw a wrench into the works of what we're doing if we don't own it.
Yeah. As I said, this, I mean, it's an issue. I have some concerns about trying to do it in-house or trying to have an engineering firm sort of take it from start to finish, but the width of the bridge is definitely something to consider. I got to admit, I've never conceived of it being wider than it already is.
Okay, and I'm just going based on the bridge plan. I'm saying for the state there, we're talking two-lane bridge. And I'm looking at the width and, well, do we even own that?
Well, you were saying this, you get two cars could pass on that, but two pickup trucks maybe not.
I think 18 and a half feet from
the bridge. 200.
And the other thing is, when we on the Stevens Road, that was all surveyed out by the surveyor to make sure we had room enough to put the culvert in.
Yeah, and it was just a concern of what that bridge plan showed online, the width, and what the town owned. When you go down and look at it, as far as historical, did we own enough to do that? That's all. Just something to look at if you didn't know.
That. Thank you. I did have a hand up.
Eric Jones, Stillings Lane, just sort of to piggyback on that, as Lawrence and Lenny may remember, when they did the Pine River Bridge, the town actually acquired more land in order to make that bridge wider. That was part of the process. That bridge was not always that wide. It was probably only a one-lane bridge when it was replaced in 1983. So they actually made the Pine River Bridge wider when they installed it.
So there may be a reason to go to one lane then.
You know, so.
I don't have a problem. I want a fire truck to be, or emergency equipment to be able to go over that bridge.
Well, the road on each side of the bridge is still only one lane.
Right.
Yeah, one lane would be
if we made it bridge two lane, and
you put a sign on
the road to make that two lane too.
No, you get the sign on the bridge. It says danger, narrow road ahead. There's a solution to everything, Lawrence.
Or alternatively, a sign that says fishing spot. You know, reserve your space, $10.
I do have a hand in the back, Mr. Potter.
Eric Potter. Town historian, Pooty Pooty Townhouse Road. When you talk about the Bryant Cemetery, I don't know off the top of my head a great deal about the Bryant family, but I know one of the boys went west about Gold Rush time, and A.J. became mayor of San Francisco. I can't tell you the degree of relationship between him and the cemetery offhand.
So you don't know if that Bryant, was that farm, is that a Bryant farm? Is that why the cemetery's there? Do you know?
That would be the only logical explanation.
Yeah, because there's nothing else around it.
Speaking of cemeteries, when they the man who puts the Memorial Day flags out, if he could get in touch with me before he goes out, because I would like to go with him again, because I want to GPS the southern cemeteries in town. I know last year we tried to get together, it just didn't work out, but I'd still like to do that because he knows where they all are, and I have that map, so any that don't have a veteran in them, at the same time I can make a note of those and go down and GPS them. Sure, I can borrow Tim's GPS again. So.
No, I have one you can borrow.
What's that?
If not, I have one you can borrow.
Okay, all right, good. Cool. Public, Mr. Thompson.
I've got a couple of things. One, talking about Stevens Road Bridge, are you going out with a set of specs on this box culvert for bridge for bid, or are you just buying it direct at, I guess, $40,000 from Mitchie?
What we've done is we've had cost estimates from, what, four companies?
Four, yes.
And Mitchie was, and I mean this word definitely significantly less than anybody else. And so we really do look at it as much the same way that we went out and priced salt sheds and then purchased the one at the best price. So, yeah.
I'm just questioning because once again, we're on tape.
Yeah.
And I don't want to see the town put in a position that it back.
Yeah, no, I do feel that the board has done due diligence on the pricing of the culverts. Yeah.
You aren't going to get caught. Okay, I got 5 points. One, confirming sidewalk.
Right.
Upper Molly Philbrook Road, Friday, the 22nd of April at 9 o'clock.
9 o'clock, yep.
Okay. Second part, attending the three selectmen, the property owner, and others. Three, will a representative of the firm which precipitated this sidewalk be present?
I'm trying to think where it's a reasonable question, and
I'm assuming it's the same firm that's going to rectify it.
Right. I have not asked whether or not that they would be willing to come. I have no reason to assume their answer one way or the other at this point.
I don't need an answer. Right. It would be interesting to know. My feeling is the scope of the work. First, complete the restoration of wetland silting.
Mm-hmm.
Two, remedy the 2015 Chapter 539 willful trespass infractions beyond the town right of way. Those are the only two things that are involved. And the fifth point is, and this is for clarification, because when Dig and Doze was in, I don't think they felt it was clarified. Realizing that selectmen Lawrence Edwards is no longer has control of scheduling or directing the summer road contract of town roads. Who does?
Well, at this point, I'm still the primary person on that, but I don't know if that's going to stand for a particularly long period of time.
Okay. I just need to know who to talk to.
Yeah, please do. Yeah.
Okay, I will. Thank you.
Yeah, as far, was that the end of your five? Yeah,
that's
okay.
Five.
As far as, I'm just trying to think of the logic of whether or not we want to meet with the property owner ourselves or whether or not without anybody else there or whether or not we want to have Dick and Doze present at the time.
I think he ought to be present. That way there he knows what Tom's talking about. And
that makes sense to me. I mean,
yeah, I don't see why you...
You know, this way he knows what's got to be done.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
You know, I mean, we're gonna have our input into it too. So, I would think he'd want to be there.
Okay. Thank you.
I mean, it makes sense for him to be there.
Yeah.
We will put a vehicle at the bottom to get you back up to yours.
So we meet at your house.
Feel free. Yes.
Okay. All right.
Thank you.
So as far as that particular, because the three of us will be there, we need to post that particular meeting. It will take place 9 o'clock.
It's already posted.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Okay. Anything else?
Also, I don't think I have those quotes in the office, just in case somebody wanted to see them for the bridge. Did you have them? Or?
Yes, in fact, I've got to make copies for you.
Great, perfect. Thank you.
Yeah, and now just so you two are aware of this, because I have mentioned this at a couple of our work sessions, is that as we develop a project, it gets a folder. And so like any bids we get, any letters we get, any communications and copies of emails that you may send to somebody or get back from somebody, they need to come to the office, right? And have mentioned to both of you that if somebody's going to email you, give them the town email. And then have them CC you, but the heading on the email is the town, right? So they send it to the town of Effingham, CC, and if you're talking to them, right, I'm talking to somebody, say, send it to the town and CC me, right? But that way it comes in, it's officially coming to the town, not to Lenny or not to Henry or not to Lawrence, right? And then if you receive emails from somebody, make sure you bring a copy and it gets put in whatever folder the project is involved with, right? Because one is like Claudia's issue on Stevens Road is the way the process started. We screwed up on the bookkeeping on it in the sense of a list of everything that came in. Stuff was coming to your house, people weren't talking to the right people and stuff like that. That kind of stuff can't happen again. It just really can't, right? Because it just slows the whole process down. So, but
we got that.
Yeah?
We got that.
Yeah, okay, yeah. But, you know, I mean, I've got, obviously, my FEMA grants and stuff like that, and then your cemetery stuff, I mean, anything like that, just keep it like that. But this keeps a good idea what the projects are. All right. We're now, Rebecca?
Hi.
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 Anything particular?
Zoning officer.
Any particular concerns from your office?
No, I've changed my office hours.
Yep.
So I'm now officially 5 to 6:30. I put that out publicly on the website and on all the bulletin boards at the beginning of this month, but I have stayed till 7 every Tuesday so far this month, just in case there was someone who came in who hadn't gotten the information.
Right.
There's not much else. Things are slow.
Yeah, the thing, work that the planning board was doing, and we had that meeting together, is that progressing okay?
As far as I can tell, I think it's in their court at the moment.
Okay.
But communication seems to be good.
Good.
I'm making myself available if I am needed. I got a nice call from someone, I think it was Mike, reminding me to check the minutes of something because he felt that it was important that I knew what had been decided. That was a ZBA call.
Right.
But still, that was very helpful.
Right.
To make sure I had checked the minutes in a timely fashion on that.
Yeah.
Because I do check them, but maybe not right after they come back.
Right. Yeah, I want to again extend my official apologies this time for when we decided on the closing the fourth Tuesday of the month of not considering your office hours.
Oh, that's no problem.
I'm sorry about
home that. Home to dinner, home it shouldn't be a problem. And any time you're here for a work session, if I need to work later, I've got work to do, and you're here, I'll stay.
Okay.
It's just that if there's no one around, I'm going to leave.
All right. Good.
And the only other thing is I'm doing my, sort of starting my spring sweep.
Yeah.
Snow's melted, weather's nice for driving around, leaves are still off so you can see what's going on. So I'm going to try over the next couple of weeks to basically hit most of the roads in town that I don't drive on a regular basis.
Right.
And just catch what might be going on, what projects people might be starting without.
Yeah. On any of your
whatever junk cars have appeared out of the suburbs.
Any of your what up letters late in response or?
I have to figure out an approach for the Rennet Road property because I didn't get any response to the letters, and since I don't know the folks personally, I'm not comfortable just going and knocking on the door.
Okay.
So we need to work through that one to figure out. I drove by today and didn't look like there was any activity. That sometimes happens. As I send out a letter, I get absolutely no response, and after a couple of circuits, I realize that they're plodding away on the project. You
right.
know, junk cars have been removed, things have been cleaned up, and I'm going, well, you know, nobody right. said they had to call me up.
Right.
I mean, I've asked them to, but if they take the letter seriously as a request to put their property in order, I see no reason to pester them.
Okay.
So I did drive by today, but it didn't look like there was any activity.
Okay.
So need to figure out that. I think basically what I'm saying is I'd prefer to go with someone.
Yeah.
So I don't know whether it would be one of you gentlemen or ask the chief or whoever.
Okay.
To do the visit with me and
right.
say, did you get the letter? What are you planning on doing?
Yeah.
Well, that's the only one that's out there without any response. There's some other things pending, but you know it's all sort of the usual process
right.
of people who, there were some thing projects that were pending, waiting on a town meeting and whatever changes were done to the ordinance.
Right.
Because if there were changes that were made that made their issues moot, I basically said, why don't you just wait?
Right.
Because if we're going in a direction that's going to make your issue moot, let's not spend a lot of time on paperwork and back and forth on it. It means that the town is responding to something that is going on.
Okay.
And I need to go back and review all those. The changes to the campground ordinance seem to be actually going pretty smoothly so far. Haven't talked to the road people, but I've been in communication with Osby Lake Camping, and we're working out a system. I changed the application form, and we have places on the form to put the square footage of the site, and whether the site predates zoning and what the existing structures are and all that kind of stuff. Right. So I think we've got a fairly simple way to track that stuff. So, and that was the only big change in terms of procedure.
But overall, that whole process is going pretty well.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah. Good. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Speaking of that, brought up an issue that I was told that we had a somebody requested that there's a particular house in town that they wanted the health officer to go check. I'm the acting health officer, but I actually live on the road that is under question, and I have talked with a health officer, I can't remember his name, out of Ossipee, and I will admit he's more of a health officer than I am because they have way more issues than we have in Effingham. And you can, under RSAs, hire the services of another town's health officer. So I don't have a written complaint at this point, but I might be able to get one. If I can get a written complaint, I'd like to act on it because I do know the situation and I don't think the person that made this request is wrong. So I'll talk to that person and see if I can get a written complaint, and if I can, I'm going to put forward to you two that I'd like to have the Ossipee health officer deal with the situation because it could be seen as of interest on my part. It could be seen that way. I think I could be neutral about it, but Caesar's wife, I want to be above suspicion on that. But let me see if I can get a written complaint. Because I mean, there's other issues that we don't respond unless we get a written complaint. And I feel the same way about this, so I'll see what I can do. And I'll bring that up in 2 weeks. So other than that, unless anybody has something, there is a hand in the back.
Ed Camone, Brookfield. I'm also your state representative. There's going to be a meeting this Saturday. It's going to be the proposal for the Carroll County Agricultural Learning Center. This involves the county farm, what will happen to the area, how the proposal is going to be put together. So the meeting is Saturday, 2 p.m. at the Mountain View Community Nursing Home.
Okay.
It's going to be like an organizational meeting. We're going to talk about the proposal of how it will work, the components to it. It was a very positive beginning at the delegation meeting. And I think if anybody's concerned or has any new ideas about that, come to the meeting, listen, and add your ideas.
Right. So if you had an interest in agriculture in Carroll County, this would be worth doing.
Yes. And if you're concerned, if you were concerned about the decisions made about the farm, come to the meeting.
Okay.
And discuss it.
And at 2 p.m. the 23rd?
Yes.
Okay.
This is just the farm, not the nursing home or the jail or anything else.
This is about the proposal for the Carroll County Agricultural Learning Center.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anything else?
Not for me.
All right. One question for Claudia. This on the as far as bookkeeping and stuff goes, we're all set for closing the fourth week as far as manifests and things like that.
Yeah, it just works payroll.
Okay.
In any necessary.
All right, I mean, but it's working out. Well, in that case, I would entertain a.
I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Second that. All those in favor? Hey, thanks everybody for coming.